Hey, welcome to this week's episode of the Content Creation Made Easy podcast. I am your host, Jen Liddy, and you are in the middle of a little series I'm doing on your website. Now, your website is probably something that you've looked at, did at one point. Maybe you look away every time you need to deal with it, or you say, don't send anybody to my website because I don't love it. That's why I'm doing this little series on your website. It doesn't have to be this horrible, traumatic thing that you have to take care of. There are little tweaks that you can do to kind of make this an asset that works for you. And today, my expert is Brittany Herzberg. So Brittany and I met, God, I don't even know how we met, but we of course met online, like I meet everybody today. And she is just one of those people who's kind of brought her specialties together in a very sharp way. And I love what she's done. So she's, you know, like, Brittany, would you say you used to be a copywriter? Because I feel like copywriter is part of who you are, but it's not what you really do anymore, right?
Well, it is still a good bit of a part of what I do, because I do write, you know, any copy that I write has SEO in it. Any copy that I write generally is for case studies. So I don't want to give it up just yet.
Okay. But like, I don't ever think of you as quote unquote just a copywriter, because you really do have this other stuff that you fold in, like your mm-hmm. SEO specialty. That's not everybody can do that. And then you've got this little expertise in creating case studies. And then I love how you kind of brought it all together for what we're going to talk about today, which are about pages. And yeah. So what I love is that Brittany's really great at helping her clients like harness the power of SEO and storytelling, which you guys know how important I think that is, and social proof to make a more impactful, purpose-driven page for you, or presence, online presence for you. And I love this part. I want to tell you this about Brittany. She's been a reliable, safe space provider for 10 plus years as a massage therapist. And this warmth of hers, this ability to make you feel safe in a place where you're pretty vulnerable, talking about yourself, sharing your expertise, sharing your stuff on your about page. That's not really for everybody. It's not really where everybody feels comfortable. Like, that's just something I think that's another facet of Brittany's expertise. So she's going to be fun. She's judgment-free, and she even has a podcast called The Basic Bee. So she likes to keep it pretty basic. So you're going to learn from Brittany. So how'd I do, Brittany? Did I encompass everything?
You did. I mean, I'm over here and I just want to be like, oh, that's so sweet. Thank you. I really appreciate that intro. That was such a nice intro. You want to follow me around for the rest of the day?
Yes, I'll tell you all the nice things about yours.
Oh, gosh.
I'm glad that you're here with us to talk about pages, because we're going to talk about all the facets of about pages that maybe people haven't thought about before, including mm-hmm. weaving in storytelling and SEO. And maybe we're going to talk a little bit about case studies, too. So you ready?
For sure. Yeah, let's go.
Can you tell us a little bit about your background? I know that you said you used to be a massage therapist. Let's talk about how you got from there to here in the online world.
The short answer is that 2020 happened. Okay. The longer version is that 2020 happened. I was home, couldn't massage my clients. There were tons of little projects that I wanted to catch up on, and one of them was revamping my website. I noticed that a lot of other people had testimonials on there, and I didn't have any, and yet people would find me on Google and decide to book with me. So I dissected my website with my clients. I was like, you know, of course, texting and emailing and calling them, and I'm like, what did you like? What stood out? Why did you book with me? And then I used that as testimonials for my website. Around the same time, I learned what an online webinar was because I attended Marisa Corcoran's. I listened to her copy chat, and then I listened to her Leave Them Wanting More masterclass, understood what an email funnel was, learned that I was a copywriter, and I was like, oh, I do this and other people, I was like, I do this and other people would pay me for it. So that was just really eye-opening for me. From there, I started writing copy for my healthcare provider friends. So I had a pediatric dentist, other massage therapists, chiropractors that I was writing things for, really just honed the craft and learned that I, you know, loved SEO because same thing happened in my massage practice, where if a client came in and they were having XYZ pain or whatever, I didn't want to just say, okay, well, I can only do this, but we could do cupping for, you know, a $10 upcharge, or we could do this for an upcharge. If someone comes into me and they have a problem, I want to just help them with all the tools that I have available. And SEO for me was one of those tools where I was like, this needs to be part of the conversation, especially for web pages. So dove into SEO, and then I learned that I was already incorporating case studies, and I was like, why aren't people doing this online? And the timing was incredible because I started talking about it, and then the online world started to catch up with me. So now everybody talks about case studies, but yeah, SEO, social proof, and storytelling, that's my jam.
There's some key things that you said that I think I would love every listener to take into account here is that you, number one, you went directly to the horse's mouth. You went to your clients and you asked them what attracted you, what resonated with you. And so you really got the audience's perspective, which I think is something that we all make mistakes with because we are the experts and we can see the problem. Like we're really insightful about seeing the problem, but we use different language than our people use. So I think that was such a huge thing to take away. So even when you're writing the about page, which is about you, I know that that's going to come into play. So I just want to pin in that. And the other thing that I really love is, like, I talk to people who are experts in their thing, and you are an expert massage therapist, but you were not necessarily an expert online business owner or copywriter. Mm-hmm. And somehow I'm very curious about how did you let yourself, or what kind of mindset shifts did you have to kind of overcome or let yourself deal with to step into this role as expert copywriter and SEO strategist?
Oh my gosh, that is a great question. And it's a story I don't get to tell very often.
Let's hear it.
It's the moment that I remember, funny enough, with my Instagram profile. I had this Instagram profile. I had been talking about massage. People had gotten to know me as this. I wasn't necessarily marketing myself as, you know, I'm a massage therapist, come book with me. Mm-hmm. It was more just like Instagram was my playground. I got to make friends. I got to make connections. I got some really cool collaborations out of it. I was just having fun. And I still think of it as a place that I go and have fun conversations and connect with people. But I was like, okay, I'm making this shift into copywriting and strategy and SEO and all of that. If I keep putting myself out here as a massage therapist, no one is going to know that they can come to me for this other stuff. So I had to make a really big decision to say, my massage practice is good. At the time I had that going and I was doing copywriting. My massage practice is good. I don't need clients for that. I need to just fully embrace this new lane of copywriting and make my profile about that. It was a very big deal for me, even though it seems really silly.
No, I bet now it seems silly, but I bet in that moment you're like, oh my God, I went to school for massage therapy. I built my whole website around. Like, I can imagine that that is an enormous decision.
Yeah, it was pretty huge. Now, I will say the thing that was easy for me is that I'm always super curious. I love being a student. I love learning. So me embracing that new path in that way was very easy for me. But the whole like expertise of like, I'm now an expert in this too. That was a jump, and it was one of those, not fake it till you make it, because I do know my stuff. Mm-hmm. And that was the thing I had to keep telling that imposter syndrome voice, like, no, I know what I'm doing. I've gotten people results. And so you have to keep like playing that in your mind and like, you know what you're doing. You've already gotten results for people. I have this thing on my computer and I'm looking at it right now. It's called my happy folder because I keep all of any kind of like positive praise I put in there, because on the days where I don't feel like that, I can just go scroll through
the evidence. Yeah, looking for the evidence.
Yeah.
That's a big one for stepping into the identity, is like looking for the evidence and also just kind of having to believe it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Oh, that's a great story. Thank you. I think that people need to be reminded of that, that you might not feel like you're an expert, but you have an expertise. And the more you lean into it, the more of an expert you become.
Exactly. Yeah, I couldn't have said that better myself.
I love that. So let's talk about pages. We are going to talk about a lot of things with about pages, but I want to first talk about when people fall on your website or land on your website, let's hoping it's more intentional than just falling on your website.
Just stumbled over here.
Just stumbled on it among the billions of web pages around there. When people land on your website, how generally do people use or navigate through a website?
I know that most people go to the homepage. It's typically where they land. Let's say they're clicking on something from an Instagram link in bio, or maybe they're clicking over from a podcast interview and it says website at the bottom. They're generally going to find themselves on the homepage. Then what they're typically going to do is jump to your about page. Okay. I would say that is the second most visited page on your website. And I'm sure there's a statistic that would very smartly sum that up. But I have even paid attention to my own user behavior. If I meet a nutritionist or if I meet another copywriter, I want to get to know them. So I'm immediately going to go over to their about page.
Because people hire people, right?
They
want to know if they're connected with that person. So when you are working with your clients, how often do you see like a neglected about page or a sad about page when you are getting started?
That is the cutest way to phrase that. Often, more often than I would like. And up until June of last year, I would have counted my website in that as well.
Oh, because, just June. Okay.
Yeah. So I don't even remember what the old copy was. And it wasn't terrible, but it wasn't what I wanted to say for where I was going, I was moving to. Yep. So it needed a refresh. It needed, you know, some paint on the walls and a new chair in the corner. And so we put that over there. But
some love
frequently.
And attention.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let's talk about, you told me before our conversation that there are like are three things that every about page must have. Like not even like these are not recommended, but like you really highly suggest that people put these three things in there. So let's, what are those top three things that people can
we'll
check
see
off?
If my answers match what I said. So definitely one of my main things is you need to have an image there. And that's not a copywriter thing. Yeah, definitely. And this showed up big time with my massage therapy practice. If someone is finding my website and committing to coming in and spending 60 to 90 minutes with me, they're going to want to know who I am. And not this is such an important distinction, not to like size me up or to profile me, but just like, who is this person? I want to put a face to the name. When clients would come see me, they were coming into a chiropractic practice. There were three or four massage therapists there on any given day.
Yeah.
Who's my person? You know?
That's a great point.
So, I mean, that is for in-person stuff, of course. That's an example for in-person. But also, if I'm online, I have countless times seen someone in someone's summit or then seen someone in a blog or a podcast interview. The point I'm making here is that I get to know these people and I'm like, oh, that's so-and-so. Oh, that's so-and-so. I was in a networking room with them. Mm. I did blank with this person, you know? So it's having those, it just builds those additional connections and that additional bond. So that is a big thing. And you can put an SEO keyword in your images, which helps you to be findable in that way. This happened with one of the images on my site where I was calling myself at the time a healthcare copywriter. Mm-hmm. So if you had Googled healthcare copywriter, my face took up the top two rows of the images.
I love that.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so great. Mm-hmm. Again, that goes down to really knowing who you serve and being really clear in who you serve. So that's super helpful. Okay. So the number one is an image of yourself.
Mm-hmm.
What would the second thing be?
I really don't know what I said on the sheet.
Oh, no,
you
didn't give me answers. You just told me like there are three things. No, you just
I must have put this. Hold on. Your editor's going to be like, what in the world? Please hold. This is comical. If I don't find my notes, it's totally fine because I've got other things I can roll with. Well, definitely the images. The other thing that I have seen and I really feel like is coming into its own is having your values or your mission on your website.
Mm-hmm.
Values, mission. You could even have that pop out to some degree in like fun facts where people are getting to know more about you, how you operate, what your business is all about. Again, do I connect with you? Do I click with you? Do I vibe with you? Whatever word you want to put there. Right. Are you the person that I want to work with? Because
who
sure you have.
To... Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
No, you're going to get on a soapbox about this stuff.
No, let's hear it.
You have the expertise. But do I like you? Do I want to work with you? Do I like your approach to things? Do I like your personality even? Because if you think about working with someone, whatever the capacity may be, I'm, like you said at the beginning so very kindly, I'm a warm person. I don't necessarily want to, I'm not going to necessarily jive with someone who's maybe like colder or more standoffish or whose trust has been broken a bajillion times and they don't want to let somebody in. That's probably not going to feel like anything except for friction for both of us, just as an example.
So when you're sharing your mission and your values and like kind of taking a stand for what you believe in on your about page, it doesn't have to be, well, the word frosty came up because that seems like it could be very clinical sometimes to share your mission or your values, but like you could really weave that in like with fun FAQs or even with maybe a story. you know, yes. to let people know more about you. So I love that weaving your mission in is important, which means you have to know your mission. You have to know what you stand for, and you have to be willing to say, this is what I stand for.
You do.
Which some people are not really ready to do. So that's another kind of just seed to plant in people's heads right now. So we've got the image of yourself, weaving in your values in some way that feels good to you. And what is there a third thing?
Yeah, the third thing I'll get to in a second. I do want to give an example of this, though, just with how someone could. I went to my website because I'm like, let me pull up something. You know, even just saying this one, it's under my fun facts. I go by B because my birth name has too much of an "it's Brittany" vibe. It also reduces the risk that my version of Brittany will be misspelled on a coffee cup. True. That you laughed. That's the goal that I have for when people read that. I'm mm-hmm. funny. I'm mm-hmm. witty. I'm not a blank, right? So like, I don't give off that vibe at all. And someone's going to get that, not just from seeing my picture, but also from reading that. The other thing with the values is that I actually wrote 6, and then I wrote what it means to me or how it shows up in my work. So you could come up with like a 1-sentence thing each for your values or your mission. Just, you know, even having a little something really makes an impact for people when they're going around.
I'm really glad you gave an example, because what I'm hearing is your values don't have to be super philosophical or super social justice focused. If that's not, you know, where you are, it really could just be like, I like to be a little silly. I don't like to take myself too seriously, or I believe everybody deserves, you know, a customized content approach. Like those kinds of things. I don't like cookie cutter things. I don't want it. Like, you could really put those things in there. So I along this line, like, encourage people to think about, how are they different from other people? Yes. And weave that in, right? Like, I'm a content person. I'm a messaging person. I'm like a brand messaging person, but I really don't love social media. And I think that's important for people to know. Like, I'm not here to teach you how to use Instagram at a very micro level. I'm here to teach you at a much different level. So that's a value that people can just weave in, and it doesn't have to be like, you know, what they stand for in terms of their politics or their, or anything else. Right.
For sure. And I would additionally just encourage you, if that's not something that really deeply resonates with you, don't put it on your website. Mm-hmm. You don't need to follow the herd with mm-hmm. everything. And people are going to feel it when it's disingenuous. People are going to feel it when that doesn't come through every single thing in your world. Like, you gave a great example with not loving social media and being all about content and marketing and messaging. I don't love paid marketing.
Yeah.
So I used to, I don't know if it's still on the website, but I used to make a joke about, I like my marketing like I like my strawberries organic, because like, I don't want to plant my flag in the paid marketing. There are friends of mine who are excellent at that, and I can send you their way.
Yes.
And I will. But that is not my jam, and I've never done paid marketing, and I don't plan to.
Yeah, I love that. That's so great. Is there a third thing?
There is a third.
Quote unquote should be on your about page?
Yes, for sure. The third thing that you really need to do with your about page, and really throughout your website, but this is the hardest page for people to wrap their brains around, you have to write your about page for and with your person. I know you know where I'm going. Yeah. With your reader in mind. It cannot be, I have 15 degrees and I did this and I did that. They don't really care about that. I'm sorry, but they just don't really. They want to know how you're going to help them. It's so hard because mm-hmm. you've worked your bum off to get where you are. You put X amount of years into getting degrees and doing all this stuff. It's not that it doesn't matter. It's just that it's not the biggest thing that someone is looking for when they come to your about page. They just want to know, do I vibe with you? And do I think that you can help me get where I want to go?
I used to own a fitness studio with 2 partners, and the person who was in charge of the actual fitness, she was the director of the fitness part. She had the degree in it, and she always wanted to lead with the foot of like where she got her degree from and where she got her training and how her training was different from other fitness trainers in the area. And I used to kind of go back and forth. We were like, they don't give a shit about that. They just want to know, is it a good workout? Can they connect with you? Is it going to be fun? Is it going to be hard? Like, those are the things that those people cared about. Mm-hmm. So it's always comes down to, what does your audience care about? And I guarantee you there will be somebody coming to your about page who cares what degrees you have, and they're going to read all the way down to find out. But that's especially for experts and people who have specialties, they don't need to lead with that foot. And that is often so foreign to them.
Mm-hmm. It's a very different feeling, especially, like I said, you've spent this time in your life and you had this big goal and money. I left that out. You spent the money. Yes. Yeah, it's a big deal to you. And it, again, it's not that it doesn't matter to them. It's just that that's not the top thing on their list that they're looking for most people. To your point, there's going to be the people who are going to look for that.
Yeah. Let's unpack what that means a little bit. So you and I both understand what it means to write something for our audience about us. So it like means to use their language. Can you dive into this or unpack it just a little bit more? How somebody who's like not, you know, immersed in the world that you and I are immersed in, how they might wrap their head around that?
Yeah. And I can even give you an example, which might help. So there's one section on my website. Most of the sections on this about page are written for the reader. I'm talking like, you did this, you believe in that. I'm aware of where they're at because I've already, going back to your previous point, I've already talked to my clients. I've already talked to my ideal people and I understand what's in their head. So I get to feel, or I get to make readers feel real creeped out because I'm like, you do this, your life looks like that. And they're like, oh my God, how do you know that?
Get out of there.
Get out of my brain. But you know, this is the type of thing, let me just read this. SEO gets them to your site. You do such an amazing job connecting with people on Instagram, hashtag same, but keyword rich and strategically crafted web copy, hello SEO, got some staying power and allows you to attract the right clients from the get-go. So what am I doing there? I'm telling them how I can help them. I'm sharing with them my framework in this section and driving the point home that I am an expert in this and I can help you. Because that is the thing that they are going to play back in their head subconsciously, most likely, as they're going through your website. Can you help me? How are you going to help me? Do you work with people like me? Those are the big things that are just like cycling. They're on replay in their head.
And do you understand me?
And do you get me? Because it'll,
you know, do you get me? Yes. Brilliant. I feel like that example is a really helpful example. And the pronoun you is so awesome for people. And if we could use the word you more frequently in our copy, we'd get a lot more traction. That's, I have a really strong belief about that. So many people start their sentences with I and nobody gives a shit. They when don't. You say you lean in more. Like, what are you going to say about me?
Right. What do you know about me? How do you know this?
Yeah. What are you going to tell me?
Yeah. And I've had copywriter mentors tell me before. So this is always like a goal of mine. The goal is to take I, change it to you.
Yep.
And then take you out of the sentence. If you can do that, you've written some like incredible copy. So even if you could just write you, I mean, you saw I just did it. So like, you don't have to be super high level, whatever. You don't have to, you know, get extra credit on this, but at least saying you and saying I less will, like you said, it'll make someone lean in a bit more.
Yes. I found, this is a parenting hack. I have a almost 17 year old. And, I use this a lot to like, you know, hey, you might like this movie that I'm going to go see tonight. It's about X, Y, and Z. And I know that you're interested in that. And I texted that to my son. And I also love that you said, like, you write it in the I first, you craft it in the, recraft it in the U, and then you tweak it. So there's definitely, like, I even find myself tweaking my texts to my son because he's a hard to communicate with teenager and I want to connect with him. And I find when I do that little hack, he's like, that sounds awesome. Can we go tonight? Like, who is this guy? Okay. Yeah. Okay. Great.
Good job, mom.
Yay. So the next thing I wanted to ask you is we've talked about SEO, and how can, and you talked about how you can weave it in, here and there, but do you have any more information for us about how to make our about page more SEO friendly?
Oh, for sure. So definitely the images are such an overlooked area that you can title your images with keywords.
Okay.
And I will say that I have a resource for this, which I'll mention later.
Awesome.
If anyone is like, SEO, teach me more, or SEO, I'm ready to stop avoiding it.
Right.
So the image titles, for sure. Any kind of hyperlinks that you use, you can also make sure that you're hyperlinking like specific keywords. Like if I were to say case study copywriter, I could hyperlink that and link it to my service. That is about me being your case study copywriter.
Mm-hmm.
If I were to talk about gathering social proof, I could hyperlink that and link it to a digital product I have. So I could be really strategic with that. And that helps Google and other search engines understand what's on your page and understand how to navigate your website, it's also something that a website visitor is going to really appreciate because they might be curious about that. Headlines, using your headlines strategically, that's a big one. And when I say strategically, making sure that there's a keyword in there so that it helps the page rank a little bit higher. Mm-hmm. Because the pages that rank, it's not just your homepage. It's not just your blog. It's not just a product page. It's all of them. Mm-hmm. They are all opportunities. What is there another one that I can think of? Definitely. Yeah, no, I think I'm going to leave it with those because if I those say others, yeah. So headlines, images, and any kind of like hyperlinks.
Mm-hmm. The step that people need to know before they do this, of course, is what are their keywords? What do they rank for?
Mm-hmm.
And so do you have any like quick hits about how to get clear on that?
Yes. And I also have a tutorial, which I'll make sure that you get. It's like a six minute YouTube video to make it really simple. But you and I have already hit on this. Start with your people. Go back, even if you've only helped two people, mm-hmm. go back and ask them, where were you stuck? What wall were you bumping up against? Why did you choose to work with me? What help were you looking for? Those are just four of the questions you could ask. Mm-hmm. But if you ask them that, or even what results did you get by working with me, ask them those questions. Do not alter their words. I'm going to say that again. Do not alter their words.
I'm clapping.
Yay! Because that is the part. Their words are gold. Because you said it earlier. We are going to talk in like the jargony version of stuff. They are going to say it just in like the normal people speak the way that somebody else is going to be Googling it.
Don't translate their words back into your expert language. That's like such a big mistake that people make.
It is. And we're not aware of it, and we don't know what we don't know, but once you know that, now you know, and you cannot claim ignorance.
So I have one last question. You have been so generous in really giving us some serious tactics. Is there any mistake or things that people can avoid doing that you just see like they're not even aware of, like one or two little nuggets of
specifically with about pages?
Yeah.
I would say it's definitely the stuff that I've talked about, not making use of the headlines. Oh, here's a big one. I didn't call this one out. The wall of text. Can we just not do that, my friend?
Readability?
Readability. We need to break that up. And I think, you know, fifth grade English class has messed all of us up for life. But, and I know that
six to seven sentences in every paragraph.
It's just not, no. You can have a one word paragraph. You can have a one word sentence. I know that sounds bizarre, but if you start writing like you speak, so this is kind of a twofer, write a little bit more how you speak and break up that text. Do not give them a wall of text because they are sure as crap not going to read it. They're just not.
So what I did, I don't know if you noticed, when you said that about the big wall of text, the mistake that I made was I turned it into the jargon. I did that thing that I'm just telling people not to do because I said readability, right? So that's a good example of what not to do with your own content. But that breaking it up, but that also goes true for captions on a post or certainly an email. Like I get these emails with just these humongous walls of text and it looks like a big building that I can't penetrate and I'm not going to try. I'm sorry. I'm just not going. I'm going to skip over it.
Yeah. And so are other people. Their eyes are going to see that and go, nope, not doing that. I don't. We're always trying to conserve energy. So our brains are trying to do that for us. So if we see a giant wall of text, we're just not going to read it. Even the diehard dedicated people are typically not going to sit there and read that text.
Yes. And this is something I wish people, like the people at my son's school who send messages to us every single day, I'm like, please just break this up a little bit. Cause I know there's important information in there, but you're making me work so hard to find it. This wall of text really needs to be chopped up a little bit. So thanks for that nugget. I'm glad we reminded of that. One question for you. I know that you're giving us a lot of resources for DIYers. I'm finding in today's world, it's sometimes you just want somebody to take a look at your stuff and do it for you or do it with you. Do you offer that as a service?
Yeah, definitely I do. And I love being able to write stuff for people. So if that's not something that's on my website, but if anyone's ever curious about it, just reach out and come find me because I love writing about pages.
Okay, awesome. So where can people find you? What's the best place for them to get into your world?
Definitely Instagram. So it's Brittany underscore Herzberg, and I'll make sure you have the link. And then my website, if you are curious about booking anything or curious if I do certain services, there's a form on my contact page. So you can just fill that out and I'll be in touch in usually like 2 to 3 days max.
Beautiful. I'm going to actually put the link to everything so that if somebody needs to rewrite their about page and they don't want to pay somebody to do it and they want to take it on themselves, they can at least use yours as a sample for like, say, you know, what to do and how to do it.
Amazing. That would be amazing. Thank you. Yeah.
You're welcome. Thank you for coming on and giving us so many gems. Anything else we need to know that I didn't drill down on?
No, you did a great job covering it. I will say I'll make sure I give you that YouTube link for the keyword research tutorial, but it always starts with talking to your people. And then the SEO basics checklist, I'll make sure you have as well. And it's free download and it's got some tutorials. So yeah.
Great. And I am on Brittany's list. So I can vouch that when you get onto her list, you're going to get valuable information from her. And she's really just lovely and easy to be around. So thank you so much, Brittany, for coming on today. This was such a nice conversation. I'm so glad to talk about pages.
Yes, of course. Thank you. That's such a nice compliment. Thank you for having me.
No problem. All right, listener, thank you so much for listening all the way through. I hope you took away some good nuggets. I hope you carve out like 45 minutes to go look at your about page and make 2 or 3 bullet points of things that you can change. Don't get overwhelmed with trying to revamp the whole thing. Just start to think about one aspect that Brittany talked about. Maybe it's working on your images, like the alt text for your images, or maybe it's doing some keyword research, but please don't take this on like a weekend warrior and feel like you have to overhaul your entire website in one day or one weekend or even 1 month. This can be just like an ongoing practice for you. So I hope that this is helpful and I'll see you on our next conversation. Thanks, Brittany. Talk to you soon.
Thank you.
Bye.